أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وآله أجمعين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي رب أوزعني أن أشكر نعمتك التي أنعمت علي وعلى والدي وأن أعمل صالحا ترضاه وأصلح لي في ذريتي إني تبت إليك وإني من المسلمين. يا مولانا أنت قاعد كده حارة كمان سيتنا سيدي يانج مان كان يكون سيتي يا let this is an elder young older man come سيتي is better not just that our teacher as well our father yeah الله يفتح عليك الله يجزيك خير thank you it is a pleasure to see you here and I'm really sorry I didn't start at 5 I had a discussion with my brother here talking about personal issues. So it took me a little bit of time, but inshallah we are going to do our talk about a subject that is important in this time and this age, because this subject is concerning too many people. And that concern should be more important for somebody who believes in Allah. But unfortunately, we live in a world today whereby many of us were not really taking these matters very serious. The subject is to do with the climate. Now, there are two differing points of view in the world. From both camps, the believers and the non-believers. Among the non-believers, there are some people who think this is all nonsense. The world we live in, as long as we are alive, we could do whatever we want. Whether it is going to be destroyed, or whether it is going to be causing us difficulties, it doesn't matter. We just live in it. In the meantime, we have got some believers and all faith. Christian, Jews, Muslims, who say, well, it doesn't matter. The world is the world, it's not going to change. These scientists who talk about climate change are talking nonsense. And those people have rich people among them, knowledgeable people among them. And in the case of those who believe, very religious people. So my talk is going to concentrate on what we as Muslims have received from the words of the Almighty Allah in regard of living on this earth. Knowing that we are physically earthlings because our bodies were created from the earth. And each one of you, if Allah give you an opportunity to go to bury somebody, you will see the Imam, after putting the body of the deceased on the ground, taking a piece of dust and saying to you, this one whom you love, take this and throw it unto him and say, from this you were created. And to where this come from, the earth, you are retained, and Allah once again will resurrect you and bring you forth for a day of reckoning. Someone whom you love, and you throw dust on them. Yet, if they are above the earth, if there is dust in them, you will wipe it away. You don't want them to look dirty. So we are earthlings. We are made of this earth. But spiritually, we are higher beings. So those two differing point of view of extreme misunderstanding of this subject from the non-believers and believers comes out of ignorance. And a believer should have knowledge. For indeed, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah began his journey by instructing him, Iqra, read, recite, learn, reflect, research, ponder. All these can be taken from that. Hence he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ مُعَلِّمًا. I indeed was only sent as a teacher. So I don't want you to look at this subject like those two extremes. And as believers, as Muslims, if you stand and speak like those who are ignorant, that's the best description I can give, ignorant of the reality, of the relationship between us who are made of this earth, not to understand that Allah has created us for a purpose. So, when they asked me to speak, they said to speak about the climate and the future. The future is very important, but we don't know it. But we can live today according to the teaching, so that the future, if not for us, for those who will come after us, will be a future that will be of benefit. Not just for them, also for us, because we strived through the teaching to leave it better for them. Now, all of you know that the climate change that is taking place in the physical format by more rain, floodings, droughts, extreme weather, heat, everybody knows, you can read it, I don't have to tell you about that. It is in the news. Sheikh Google can give you a lot of information, more than I can give you myself. But you also know that this climate change changes the environment through which we live. I live in a land in Northeast Africa, in Sudan. When I was young, it was green, beautiful. We used to export a lot of the agricultural products like sesame seeds and peanuts, Arabian gum, from that land to Europe, America, to all over the world. Today it is dry. Not semi-desert, total desert. Unless there is rain, there is nothing you can yield from that land. So the environment that I used to live in almost 45, 50 years ago, is totally changed. And I cannot deny that, and this is happening all over the world. Another thing, when I came to Britain in 1977, 4th September, yesterday I was looking at home, and I found the receipt of the hotel I stayed in. My bedroom cost me £6.75 per night in central London. That is in 1977. When I arrived in my college in September, it was snow maybe 2 feet up the ground. And this is the first time in my life I see snow. Without knowing, I'm dressed like coming from Sudan with just a shirt and a t-shirt, with normal shoes that I wear for the normal road. I was walking home and I slipped, and there is nobody inside, and I fell into my back. I spent maybe half an hour, I couldn't get up. Only Allah helped me. Alhamdulillah, and I got up and I went. I could have broken my back, but I didn't know. I'm saying this because then the weather, and now it's not the same. London used to have a lot of snow when I arrived in London in 1980. But now very rarely you see snow in London taking place. Therefore, the question I'm raising tonight, what is the duty of humanity, communities, societies, and us individually as human beings towards the climate change? And for us as believers, if we truly believe in Allah, what is our duty toward the environment that we live in? But before I answer that, we need to understand the reason why this thing is happening, or the reasons why Allah is allowing this to happen. Now, there is something that you hear a lot of people talking about. My brother here is a professor in university. You talk about this thing. Simple words, but it's creating all this havoc. In Arabic, we call it tanmiyah. In English, it's called development. Man wants to develop. But man is naive, is weak, forgetful, and selfish, and self-centered. Europe, when they were in the Dark Ages and they tried to go out and develop themselves, they rushed to other land, the Americas, South and North, okay? Australia, Africa, Asia, and they conquer the land not to benefit the people they are going to go to, so that they can reap the benefit of that land. And one of the things that they did, anybody who crossed them, they just killed them. And once they put their hand on the land, they registered it to own it for themselves. It happened in my own country. Our own land was taken away. And it's nonsense. And today you see people trying to come out of poverty and drought and war and whatever happening to find a better life, and they are drowning in the sea. Which is sad. I wish I can stand up in parliament and say to the parliamentarian, all of you should know the history of these people here. You went all over the world. The Americans who are living in America today, they're not really the people of America. Just like they tell us today, you are foreigners living in our land, go back home. Every European living in America or South America or Africa or Asia should come back to Europe. The Pope who's in Rome today, he said it when he went to America and he stood in the Congress and told them, you are making difficulties for refugees to come in America and making it difficult all over the place. Remember, we are all refugees. I'm from South America. I'm myself originally from Europe. We're all refugees. So, development is the cause of climate change if it is not taken the right way. There is a subject that people don't think about seriously. And when somebody says, I'm studying this subject, people don't really care about it much. That subject is called philosophy. Falsafa in Arabic. The philosophy is a very beautiful subject that tells you whether people, when they are doing anything in their life, is the right way they have chosen to do whatever they want to accomplish, or the wrong way. So if you look at the philosophy of development in the world, it's terrible. The last president of America, Trump, he didn't want to believe in the environment changes of the world and the climate change, because he wants development of his country through the old ways, by burning coal and doing all those things that changes the environment, because it is the means of making more money. Why? Because he's a rich man. So by saying this to you, I'm trying to tell you that today's world development is not really taken for benefiting the human who are living on the earth, but the development for making those who are rich, richer. Those who are powerful, more powerful. Look at China. Look at America. Look at Russia. They don't really care. They will do their utmost, and they compete with one another. Just we had the conference in Scotland to discuss this matter. What did they come out with? Nonsense. It took a 14 or 15 years old girl from Scandinavia to tell them what you are talking about is all just blah, 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 blah. That's what she's saying. And it is. They meet, they eat, they drink, they write whatever they write, and then nothing is done. But I believe it is us who can make the change. And I will prove this to you if we can take it seriously. What does development mean? It means building factories to fulfill our needs, in order for goods to travel from place to place, opening motorways and roads and train lines and building airports, and building for the people who will do this, big buildings, You could see in the Middle East, like Dubai. When I was young, it was a desert. Today, look at it. There's not one single foot in Dubai to build in. And they're going higher and higher and higher. As the Prophet Salatam says, there will come a day when they will compete on who will build the tallest building. And this has been proven today by what we see in the media. And forget about this. You might say these things we need. Looking for land to cultivate, to bring more produce. Like in South America. They are cutting trees so that they can grow coffee. In the case of those who are doing absolutely wrong, so that they can grow their cocaine and whatever, do all this nonsense. So that which will bring the benefit of the earth is being chopped away for personal gain. And this, if it is not organized properly, it will not just change the environment, the way you look at it, but it will change it even for benefiting from it. However, there is another development that we forget. In order to do all this development in the material, physical world, we need the development of the human. You might ask me how. The human who is going to develop this earth must be equipped with knowledge, must be given the experience of putting that knowledge to practice, must be given the chance to reflect upon that which is being gained or lost, must also be given a chance to research. And that's the way Allah has made the human to be developed. But in Allah's way, development of the human being is by removing the selfish desires. For you are not going to live for yourself. You are going to live for others. لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. None of you can claim to be a believer until you love for your brother or sister that which you love for yourself. And this is what is not happening today. The whole world is becoming a very selfish place. Everybody is working for themselves. A person will push his mother and father from the way if it will deprive them from achieving what they want. You might say to me, this is not happening. But believe me, it is happening. And you see it when a father dies or a mother dies, how the children fight over the inheritance. Yet many of them have not even been there to see the end of their parents' life, or to look after them, or to care for them, or to provide nothing. They are fighting for the inheritance. And some, even if they don't find anything, rather than thanking God for what they did for them and raised them to when they were young, they curse them for leaving nothing. And this is all true. Allah said in the Quran, in Surah Ar-Rum, verse 41, for those who registered to reflect, الروم verse 41 أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس. Allah is speaking. He says, corruption has appeared on the sea, on the water, and on the land. Why? For that which people did by their own hands. So what is happening to the environment we live in, it's because of what we have done or what we are doing in this present time. The scholars who wrote the tafsir, the explanation of these verses, he says, when Allah says this, he literally means when you are not reflecting upon your purpose of being human living on this earth and why you are here and what you are supposed to do, then Allah will reduce the quality of the life that you live in this world. And that happens because of disobedience. I'm telling you today, I lived maybe longer than anybody living here in this room. I had never seen a time more easy in achieving things materially, but more difficult in achieving things spiritually because people are too far away from it. Even for the believers. You see it in the masjid. When the musalli will come rushing to the masjid and going to the imam and instructing the imam, could you please rush it because I have dunya to run after. And when he is not adhering, they stand up and tell him off. What is this? We're not coming here to wait. We are coming here to pray. We want to do it. It's a chore. It's a weight we are carrying. Yet when you look at our messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who was the example for us, he used to rush earlier than the time for salah and telling Bilal, hasten and call for the salah so that we can be comforted standing in the presence of our creator. Arihna biha ya Bilal. Arihna biha. So that's a big difference. When you look at the two, it's a very, very big difference. And each one of you should think about that. Now, you need to know from this, this earth can never be a place of a blessing for a human being. Think about just yourself, without obedience. And the Quran has given us the following. That it is lawful for us living on this earth that every creature and every creation on this earth and that which is in the heaven which we can reach, we're allowed to interact with and benefit from, but with Allah's limits. I'm not going to read the verses. There are 20 of them in the Quran. There are limits. Don't cross Allah's limits. Hududillah. If you cross them, Allah will be cross with you. Not for this benefiting him or benefiting him, for your own self. For it is indeed Allah need no one, but he is sufficient for himself. Number two, that acting without permission from him is indeed the gravest of transgression and will bring the wrath of Allah upon you personally. You might think, it doesn't matter. It matters. A very good example, a sign of a believer who have very little iman in their hearts is when they walk in the path, in the street, and they see any object that can harm any other creature and they remove it so that nobody could be harmed. That is a sign of iman in their heart. Imatul adha an al-tariq. Imagine. Because it shows mercy. Remembering Sayyidina Muhammad Sallam says, Man la yarham, la yurham. The one who will not be able to show mercy will never be shown mercy. Number three, that in dealing with the creation of Allah, you must deal with them according to the way Allah has prescribed or his messengers or teachers who are teaching you to act upon, otherwise you will be responsible before Allah. You cannot do things because you think it should be done this way. Learn. Allah said in the Quran, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Say to them, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, are those who have possessed knowledge equal to those who have no knowledge? Indeed, they will never be equal. Those who have knowledge, they have light, and those who have no knowledge, they are in the dark. And number four, and finally, and it is upon us to be warned and to be careful to change anything of the creation of Allah without knowledge. But when I look at our world today and I say it is terrible to see this world today like this, it's amazing when you see human beings educated, cultured, in very good position, looking in the mirror and not liking to see what they see. My nose is too long, too crooked, my chin is too long, my cheeks are too fat. And they go and there are these pathetic people who are willing to strip them from their wealth to make them look more beautiful. Indeed, they are making them look more ugly. And this is sad. Plastic surgery is one of the worst things humans are doing today. Yes, there is a place for it, for somebody who's been harmed in an accident, in fire, whatever. They can do something to help them. But if Allah created you the way you are you saying to Allah, you are wrong in giving me this shape? Our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to look at the mirror and he taught us by saying, Allahumma hassin khuluqi. Oh Allah, perfect my behavior, my conduct, my manners. Kama hassanta khalqi, as you have perfected my creation. When you look at yourself and then you criticize, you're not criticizing yourself, but you are criticizing the one who created you. Alaysa Allahu bi ahsanil khaliqin aw bi ahkamil hakimin? Isn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the best who created? The wisest of those who judge? Who are you to judge for him? We look at Picasso. He drawn drawings for many of us, they look ugly. But to him they were beautiful. Who are you to criticize him? Those who criticized him in his time, today they are weeping. Why? Because his drawings are bringing millions. Because those who understand them, they buy them for that value. And this is something that you need to reflect upon. All this can lead us to one thing. That there is a creator who created everything. And everything created with proper proportions. Allah said in Surah Al-Mu'minun, verse 14, فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنُ الْخَالِقِينَ. Tabarak is one of the names of Allah. Literal meaning, most glorified, most exalted, most raised to the highest, loftiest position is Allah. None beside Him. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Nothing is like Allah. He is the best in creation. You know, subhanAllah, you are living in a world today, they are asking you to make siyah. Go out and travel and enjoy yourself. Some of you, can brother move a little bit forward, so that those who come in, please move forward. Give other brothers who come chance, yeah? Some of you travel the world and go and visit museums. Some of you go and visit certain sites. Some go and travel and go to the beach for 2 weeks and just come back. Siyaha. I just met a man, an old man in Sudan, when I went before this COVID business. And he told me his father, he's just an old man, that his father, he used to go and make siyaha. Okay? Which in English is a tourism. But their siyaha was to travel on the land, just being one with nature, through woods, mountain, sleeping alone, making your salah alone, reflecting upon the creation before you, harming nothing or no one, doing as much as you can to facilitate for everything you meet, you know or you don't know, an easy passage. But these men, because of that, Allah has opened their hearts and they will do things that you can never imagine. Because they understood the purpose of the Creator and the creations. Can I ask those brothers who are sitting, the three there, can sit on the floor, let the sisters who are coming, please. I'm so sorry about that. Sisters, you can come in. Yeah. Come closer this way. I'm so sorry. Pray that Allah give us a bigger place. Come in. May Allah give us a bigger place. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best who creates. So when you travel to go for your tourism, and if you go and look at beautiful places, please be wise and look at volcanoes, look at waterfalls, look at mountain range, look at even the desert. Is there any more beautiful art than what Allah has created already? No artist can draw like Allah. إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْمُصَوِّرُ. It is He, Allah, who shapes things perfect. فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنُ الْخَالِقِينَ. I wanted to think of that. Never see something more perfect than what Allah has done. And I'm saying this because one of the dilemmas we have today in the world, people even change themselves. Don't you think Allah is upset with that? This is one of the reasons why Allah says corruption has increased on the land and the water and the land. In Surah Al-Qamar, verse 49, Allah said, إِنَّا كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلَغْنَاهُ بِقَدَرٍ. O humans, remember, we do not just create things just like that. If I, the weak, the vulnerable, the nothing in the creation compared to what Allah has created, Allah said in the Quran, وَلَخَلْغُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَكْبَرُ مِنْ خَلْغَ الْإِنسَانِ. Indeed, the creation of the heaven and the earth is greater than the creation of man in the physical form. He's comparing physical to physical. We are very small. I plan my things to do in my day, in my work. You, if you are going to travel to another country, you plan your journey. When you go to school, there is a plan for learning. When if you are working in a factory, in a office, there is meeting, there is minute taken, and there are plan. Short term, medium term, long term, strategic plans. And yet there are human beings like us with knowledge, and they think still this world is just came from nothing, and we will die and there will be nothing. How sad. Allah says everything is created with perfect proportions for a reason. Not created for nothing. إِنَّا كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقْنَاهُ بِقَدَرٍ. Everything we created is in proportion and destined for a reason. In Surah Ghafir, verse 62, Allah said, ذَلِكُمُ اللَّهِ. The one who creates perfectly, indeed is your Lord Allah. رَبُّكُمْ. Your Lord. خَالِقُ كُلُّ شَيْءٍ. The creator of everything that you know or you don't know, لا إله إلا هو. None is worthy to be remembered or worshipped but him, سبحانه وتعالى. لا إله إلا هو. We Muslims are so naive. Our Islam is built upon لا إله إلا الله. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من قال لا إله إلا الله دخل الجنة. Whosoever said there is none worthy to be worshipped but Allah will enter Jannah. But yet, we don't comprehend and understand this La ilaha illallah. You hear some people, Tawheed, Tawheed, Tawheed. But yet, within themselves, are all over the place. A person who have Allah in their heart, they are united with everything and everyone. How? Not in physical term, but spiritually their heart will be pumping love through the mercy they have received, because La ilaha illallah come from Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the most merciful, the compassionate. Allah said to Sayyidina Muhammad Sallam in the Quran in Surah Muhammad, فَعَلَّمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Be aware, O Muhammad, there is none worthy to be worshipped but Allah. So here, this is a reminder that Allah, your Lord, is the one who created everything. In Surah Al-Anbiya, verse 22, Allah said, لَوْ كَانَتْ فِيهِمَا آلِهَةٌ إِلَّا اللَّهِ لَفَذَتَتَا فَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهُ رَبَّ الْعَرْشِ عَمَّا يَصِفُونَ. Some people think, oh, there are gods. I am saddened. Even some Muslims sometimes, they misunderstand the oneness of Allah. Allah is nothing like anything. Anything that comes to your mind. To be Allah, reject it. Because there is nothing that you can think of to be Allah. You know, there is in the Sufi journey, from the beginning when the person like a baby beginning to sit up to crawl, to the time when they see nothing but Allah. This station, every human being have the right to achieve. What does it mean? It means When we say La ilaha illallah, there is none worthy to be worshipped except Allah. Even yourself should not be there. Even yourself. But because we look at the physical being, this vehicle we are in, we act upon everything we do, right or wrong, to fulfill the need of this physical vehicle. Just like when I came to Britain, one of the strangest things I have seen in the 70s, the Englishman who loves his car so much, he neglects his wife, he neglects his pets, he neglects his parents, his children. He spent all his time when he's free just pumping that car, shining it, cleaning it, changing it, doing it. Where is John? John is in his car. What is he doing? Just what is he doing? This is what we are doing today. Focusing on the physical need of this physical body, which one day will be dust. Where are our fathers? Where are our elders? Where are our wise men and women who lived on this earth and did right? They are beneath it. Nothing is with them but their good action that they have carried with them. Everyone who claimed to love them, they left behind. Every gain they gained materially, they left behind. The only thing that they have gained is one thing, the goodness that they have achieved, and it will be presented before Allah in the day of judgment for them. And therefore, my brothers and sisters, man was created to live on this earth by Allah's permission. Hence Allah created his body from the earth to remind him. And he is being given the chance to build on this earth his dwellings and anything else he needs to survive. But he must do it according to what is permitted and in the right way. And must not corrupt the earth. In Surah Al-A'raf, verse 74 and verse 85. 85 Allah says, وَلَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ بَعْدَ إِصْلَاحِهَا ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. And remember, O children of Adam, do not go out of your way to corrupt this earth after Allah has made it perfect for you. Yes. Allah has made it perfect. Everything Allah create, he perfect. But we should not corrupt it. And we do corrupt it. Look what happened in Africa. The European came. Africa was beautiful. You go from North Africa until South Africa. It's green. It is jungle. It is the most beautiful creatures. What did they do? They came in my own country. They cut the abanus, the mahogany trees. You go to all those rich men in this country, all inside is wood. Where it come from? They don't have abanus and mahogany in this country. It came from where I come from. They cut every tree. And what they did then, after that, they cut all the land to cultivate what they need to bring back home. Not what we need back there to eat and drink and to survive. They cultivated cotton, for goodness sake. We don't eat cotton. And we were not allowed to grow wheat or anything, just cotton. Because Britain needs cotton. That's it. And you are not afford to own it. You work in it. You earn your pathetic living from it. And you are just a slave. And it's written in the history. If you are allowed to open the history and read. But they don't say it. They don't teach it in their history. And what they did, which really make me sometimes wonder, they made that land barren. They took everything out of it. And they destroyed history, culture, and a lot of knowledge that people who are living today, if you ask them, they have no knowledge about it. And those who are inheriting it, nobody is allowing them to learn anything out of it. They corrupted that land. And Allah had made it perfect for those who used to live in it. In verse 74, Al-A'raf, Allah said, فَذْكُرُوا آلَى اللَّهِ. O children of Adam, O you who believe, remember the benefits Allah has brought for you. Allah has provided for you. وَلَا تَعْثَوْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مُفْسِدِينَ. And do not spend your time and effort and energy on this earth to corrupt it. You might ask me, how? Corrupting it by abusing what Allah has given to you. There is too much abuse. If you look yourself, go to your home. How much do we buy? Do we need all of it? And everything today manufactured so that we can buy something else in 3 months, 6 months. And I will tell you what Allah said about that when we come to the end of this talk, inshallah. Therefore, every human must realize that Allah has created everything that we know of and we don't know of for ourselves. In a hadith Qudsi, a holy saying, Jibreel said to the Prophet ﷺ, Allah told me, and he says, Ibn Adam, O son of Adam, daughter of Adam, خَلَقْتُكَ لِأَجْلِي, I created you for my sake. So you and me and everyone, Allah created us for him, out of love. وَخَلَقْتَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ لِأَجْلَكَ, and I created everything else for your sake, to benefit from, so that you can survive and live and benefit. فَلَا تَشْغِلْ نَفْسَكَ بِمَا خَلَغْتَهُ لِأَجْلِكَ, do not busy yourself with that which I created for you. Like a child wasting his time with his toys, not giving time to his parents who want to sit and talk to him, or his teachers want to teach him. بَلْ فَشْغِلْ نَفْسَكَ بِي, however, busy yourself with me. Please be honest with yourself. How much time do you feel busy with Allah? You have 24 hours. Okay, give your doctor 8 hours of sleeping, because he asked you to sleep 8 hours. Give your employer 8 hours, he asked you to sleep for 8 hours. You have got another 8 hours, what do you do with them? Don't tell me you don't have time. We all have time. But some of us utilize our time properly, some of us we waste our time. And this is one of the things that is destroying our world today, because a lot of people are wasting time, not doing that which will bring benefit to humanity. Okay? Therefore Allah says that in order for us to live in this life, there are two ways. You choose one. Either you become close to Allah, or you are distancing yourself from Allah. And this is what you are coming here for today. The change of the environment, because of the change of the climate, for a believer, is serious enough to put you in one of the two camps. So if you are a true believer, you are in the first camp I'm going to mention, which to hold tight unto Allah through the Quran, His word that He has sent to you, through the blessed heart of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who have received it from the blessed spirit Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam, نَذَلَّ بِهِ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ الرُّوحَ الْأَمِينَ, came down with it into your heart, the trusted spirit, Jibreel alayhi salam. And Sayyidina Muhammad salam is the true spirit who received it, and from his heart it came to our heart. So you must hold on to the Quran, not just reading it for blessings, but you must live it. Live the Quran so that you can be alive and everything else can become alive through you. The Prophet is described, كان قرآنا يمشي, he was a walking Quran. He wasn't cutting a book in the shape of a Quran and walking with it. Literally everything he says and everything he does, if you look into the teaching of the Quran, he will be fulfilling it. That which says do, he does, or is strive to do. That which Allah says don't, he absolutely keep away from. And that is Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay? Allah said in the Quran, for those people who will do that, in order to benefit themselves and the environment they live in, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ, underline, أيوة, وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا, whosoever has righteous good actions, مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى, whether you are a male or a female, it doesn't matter to Allah. You are a male or a female, through your genetics, through your physical being. But spiritually, we are all the same. As I say always, electricity is the same. Whether you have a little lamp you bought for 15 pence from the £1 shop, or you have a chandelier you bought from Harrods for £50,000, doesn't matter. The electricity will give the light in both is the same. But this one is cheap and that one is expensive. So human could look different physically, but spiritually, they are the same. Whosoever does righteous good action, whether they are male or female, however they are believers. You might say, Sheikh, we are all sitting here, we are believers. Allah says no. Allah says, do not say or utter by your tongue that you believe in me until Iman enters into your heart. وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانَ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ When the Iman enters into your heart, then claim. What does that mean? The Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, الْإِيمَانُ مَا وَغَرَ فِي الْقَلْبِ وَصَدَّغَهُ الْعَمَلِ Iman is that which is being entrusted in your heart, but proven by your action. So the believers' action are a proof that their heart is enlightened and their heart is lit by the light of Iman from the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you are in that position, Allah says, فَلَنُحْيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا For this one, we are going to allow them to live a beautiful, magnificent, beautiful life. Not just here for the dunya only, وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنَ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ And in the day of judgment, we will not just reward them, we will reward them for the best that they have done. My brothers, my sisters, this is the camp you need to be in. The climate change and the environment upheaval that is taking place is because of what we do on this earth. If we do righteous good actions, if we try our best to benefit not ourselves, but everyone we know or we don't know, enjoying right and forbid evil, then Allah will allow us to live a good life here and reward us with the greatest of reward in the day of judgment. Listen to this hadith. To prove what I'm saying, Imam Ahmad radiallahu ta'ala anhu fil musnad, he reported on Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, may Allah bless Abdullah ibn Umar and his father, who said, Qala Rasulullah sallam, the messenger peace be upon him said, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ أَسْلَمَ Successful is the one who submit to what they have learned. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ أَسْلَمَ أَسْلَمَ meaning to submit, to accept. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ أَسْلَمَ وَرُزِغَ كَفَافَ And Allah has provided them very little in provision. Very little. They're not even having more than what they need. Just sufficient. وَغَنَّعَهُ اللَّهُ مَا أَتَاهُ And Allah made them self-content for what they have received. This is very, very important. A believer who's trying to help this world to survive will turn to Allah. We'll look at the teaching that Allah has gave to us because we are a part of the earth. We will look after this earth. We'll do everything in doing that which will be sufficient, not just to benefit us, those around us, but we will never cross the lines that Allah has made because only through His permission we can benefit. But look at the other camp and see whether you fit there or you are not. And the one who will go against the teaching and do not hold on to Allah and His words or listen to the advice given by His Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he will overindulge and he will waste and he will be in the midst of the losers. And listen what the Quran is saying. Verse 26-27, Surah Al-Isra. وَآتِ ذَا الْقُرْبَى حَقَّهُ If you are a believer, the person who is related to you, give them the right. وَلِذَوْجِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقٍّ For your partner in marriage, there is a right. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا and for your parents, there is a right. Ulul arham, and all those who are related to you by blood. Wajjar al-junub, and your neighbor who is next to you. And anybody else that you come across, even if you accompany them for 1 hour, Allah will question you in the day of judgment, in their benefit or in their loss when they interacted with you. Inna Allah la yas'alu an suhbas sa'ah. Indeed, Allah will ask you about the companionship you had with one person for 1 hour, whether you benefited them or you made them lose. وآتِ ذَا الْقُرْبَى حَقَّهُ وَالْمِسْكِينَ, and you must look after those who are in need. وَابْنَ السَّبِيلِ, and the travelers who are unable to look after themselves. وَلَا تُبَذِّرْ تَبْذِيرًا, and do not squander, do not waste. We live in a world today, even us, don't deny this. We cook food, we know we're not gonna eat it. And wallahi, Allah will question us. I have seen in many homes, the mothers will cook the pot of food, the children will come. What did you cook, ma'am? I cook chicken curry. Oh, we don't feel like it. Okay, ring the takeaway. What do you want? We want whatever. And this is thrown in the bin. You know what this means? This is bad for the environment, because this food that your mother has just cooked and is thrown in the bin, that means we need to make a lot of food. We need to cut more trees, to plant more wheat, to do all those things, to make land, to create more places for animals, to grow all this food for you, will destroy the environment. It's not only the fume that come out of the factories that is destroying the earth. It is the waste. Once upon a time, in Green Street, parallel to Oxford Street in central London, a Sudanese old man, very good man, rang me, said, Sheikh, you always tell us not to squander. I'm not a squanderer. I'm working for a man who owns a house here with 17 bedrooms. Each room has its own bathroom. And we have a full floor of an industrial kitchen. And I have guest areas, and I'm responsible for this home. And I have a chef and 2 workers, so that if any guests come, we should prepare for them. Tell me, Sheikh, when I receive a guest or two, and then they bring me in the morning a van. From every fruit, there is a box. From every vegetable, there is a box. And all the other material I need, and 2 whole sheep, and 20, 30 chickens. And they ask me to prepare a big meal. And I cook a whole sheep. And I cook 3, 4 chickens. And I do all the different things, and I put in the table, and those 2 kids who came for a holiday, they come down, I say, your lunch or your dinner is ready. They say, where is it? They look at it, can you ring us a car, a limousine? Why? We want to go eat out. But I cooked all this. We don't feel like it. What am I gonna do? I said, what do you do? He said, I have to put it all in the bin to be thrown, because tomorrow I have to cook again. Because the instruction coming from the manager, cook every day. He said, even if they sat and eat, they will just touch. How can a man eat more than what their belly full is in need? Am I going to be in those groups Allah described in the Quran as khasirin, as losers? And he was almost crying, because he's half of the Quran. I'm just working. I said, no. Thank you for telling me. Wait, I rang somebody. I said, do you know any community whereby we can take that food and give it to them? And alhamdulillah, we did. And from that time, whenever there is cooking, he will put it all together properly. Somebody with cars will go and pick it and give it out. But even in our own homes, when you do yourself toast in the morning, you are going to work. You might say, just not, it's worth nothing. A toast costs 2 pence, 1 pence when I buy. When you put your 2 toasts, and you rush eat one, you couldn't eat the second one, and you throw it in the bin. وَلَتُزْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. وَلَتُزْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ. In the day of judgment, you are going to be asked about this ni'mah, because you have wasted it. And listen what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says. وَلَا تُبَذِّرْ. Do not waste. إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ. For indeed the wasters are the brethren of the devils. وَكَانَ الشَّيْطَانُ لِلْرَبِّهِ كَفُورًا. For Shaitan rejected his Lord. And if you are his brother, that means Allah is telling you, by wasting, by squandering, you are rejecting me. You don't need to go to demonstrations. You don't need to go and tie yourself to a tree or hug a tree to save the environment. You need not to waste at home. Make it from tonight. Allah is my witness. Allahumma hal ballaght fashhad. Oh Allah, be my witness and inform them. Don't take more food in your plate and eat little and throw the rest. Wallahi, Allah is my witness. I find it so hard when food is thrown. It makes me quench inside. Sheikh Nadim rahmatullah alayh used to take even one rice. Yes. He will take one rice left in his plate. He will put his finger, put it in his mouth. Why? Because this is a ni'mah. There are people, you see now, Allah is showing you in your media, open your telephone. There are children in Asia, in Africa, South America, when there is drought, they throw from the plain food for them, grain, not even cooked. They will run to pick it one by one. And you are throwing this one away. That child could have put it in his mouth. You are going to be questioned about it. You are not helping the environment. Al-A'raf, verse 31. وَكُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا. O children of Adam, you are allowed to eat and drink. We're not saying don't eat and drink. Eat and drink. وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا. But do not overindulge. Don't eat more than you need. Don't drink more than you need. إِنَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُسْرِفِينَ. Allah dislikes those who overindulge. In Ramadan, we are fasting. When you are the Muslim, they are all talking, oh, we are fasting to feel the feeling of the poor. Oh, you who do not understand. The poor is feeling the feeling every day. You are feeling it for a few hours, but you are waiting for the meal and you are cooking food that you do not even eat before or after Ramadan. You are cooking a special food. And you are putting the table full of food and you are eating and wasting until you are full. When people say, have more drink, I have no place for it. Some even cannot go and pray Taraweeh. When you ask them why, I can't. I'm too full. Yet, some of the clever ones say, oh, you should have eaten third because third is sunnah. That's not true. Third is not sunnah. Third is indulging. But allowed indulgence. Allowed. The Prophet ﷺ said, حسب المرء لقيمات يقمن صلبه. The need for the human to stand on his feet to be able to function physically, few mouthful. فإن كان لابد. However, if that person cannot survive on those few mouthful or few morsels, فثلث. Then eat a third. Why? وثلث لشرابه. Then leave a third for your liquid. And leave the last third for breathing. So when you hear a brother or a sister saying, I'm too full, I cannot even breathe, astaghfirullah al-azim. Innahu la yuhibbu al-musrifin. He is somebody, run away from them. Allah doesn't like them. This is clear, this is instruction. Eat and drink. Allah said, eat and drink. I'm not refusing you, I created it for you. But do not overeat, do not overdrink. Now, the human being need to ask himself, this person who is in this camp, man ana, who am I? Min ayna jit, where did I come from? Maada af'alu huna, what am I doing in this world? Ila ayna ana dahib, where is my journey going to end? The naive will say, my journey is ending with the chemistry of the earth. I will be earth and that's it, it's finished. But the wise one knows there is a day of resurrection and there are questions to be asked and there is heaven and there is hell. Allah said in the Quran, in Surah Al-Mulk, verse 1 and 2, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير. تبارك is the one who possesses everything in his kingdom and he is able to do everything. الذي خلق الموت والحياة, the one who created death, a life, ليبلوكم, to test you, أيكم أحسن عملا, which of you is righteous and best in their deeds. وهو العزيز الغفور, it is he, the exalted, the forgiver. So this is for us to ask ourselves, reflect, who am I? The Prophet said, من عرف نفسه عرف ربه. Whosoever got to know himself will get to know Allah. But if you don't know yourself, you are lost. And once you get to know Allah, the rest will be fulfilled for you, because Allah will inform you who you are, where you came from, what's happening in this world, and what I want from you, and what will happen if you succeed or if you fail. However, the believer, we who are sitting here, we claim to be believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to strive. To strive so, come, welcome. To strive so much, okay, against our egos, to nurture ourselves, to raise our humanity, to be in a position Allah will be pleased with us. Upon what? Upon obedience, to do good, and to leave that which Allah has forbidden, and to be able to love the needy, the poor, the destitute, the homeless. We Muslims, wallahi, Allah has given us so much, especially living in this land now, where the world is in turmoil. You know, in the Day of Judgment, our questioning is not going to be like the people who are living in Sudan or Egypt or Bangladesh or Pakistan or Cyprus. Life there is more difficult. Life here is so easy. Allah is going to question us so much. I provided for you an abode where there is peace and security. If you did not able to receive your sustenance through your own actions or work, I provided a government that can provide for you a home, a roof over your head, and benefits, and free education, free health. You have everything. What did you do with that? What did you do to benefit yourself so that you, the example on behalf of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, have carried that message to the people of Islam? Or are we ignorant, just saying, oh, they're kuffar? It makes me so angry when someone said, oh, my neighbors are all kuffar. What do you expect? Because you did not even invite them. Oh, I don't know anything. What do you mean you don't know anything? Go and get to know. اطلبوا العلم. Seek knowledge. But do not utter by your tongue to anybody to do anything without you doing it first for yourself. يا أيها الذين آمنوا, or you who believe, لِمَ تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. Why do you say that which you do not act upon yourself? كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَن تَقُولُ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. It is indeed a grave sin to say that which you do not act upon yourself. So we be careful with our neighbors. When we cook something nice for our family, ring the bell, give them something. When you see them, smile in their faces, ask them, how are you? What's happening? I saw some of the Muslims, when they see that, they run away from them. When you say, why? Oh, kafir. What is this nonsense? The Prophet didn't used to run away from them. And the saddest thing that makes my heart bleed is those who think they know da'wah, when they meet a new convert Muslim, are you still living with your family? Astaghfirullah al-Azim. Why? Are you eating their food? Do they drink? Yeah, of course they drink. Do they eat pork? Yeah, they do. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. They're kuffar, my brother. Don't eat their food. What is this nonsense? Who is this person? You know, you're not allowed to give da'wah unless you have permission from Allah. Allah gave the Prophet his permission. Ya ayyuha an-nabiyyu, O you Prophet, inna arsalnaka, we sent you shahidan, a witness, that you deliver the message. Wa mubashiran, and one who give good tidings to those who are doing good or will do good. Wa nadhira, and a warner to those who are not listening and those who are doing evil. Wa da'iyan ila Allah, and a caller to Allah, bi idhnihi, by his permission. Now every Tom, Dick and Harry, I'm giving them a da'wah. And they laugh at those who are Sufis because they think, oh, this is not the right way. Wallahi, they are the only one in this moment of time who have that right, because they have a sanad, They have a chain. عن Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we be careful what we say and what we do. Okay? And therefore, we need to learn. Okay? So that we can nurture our nafs to leave the evil and to build the good. So that we can do the righteous thing and love the poor and act here for the hereafter. Not working for this dunya. What we need to do, and this is what I'm going to finish with. Number one, the Prophet was told first, Iqra, read Surah Al-Alaq verse 1. Iqra. Thank you for coming to listen. But this is not really learning. This is informing. To learn, you sit down like you go to university, college, school, and you have a syllabus and you study it. Join a college, join a course where there are books taught. I used to teach some subject, and I'm going to start again, inshallah. One of the things I want to do, I started the seerah, and I taught until Uhud. Ask Rumi's cave people, they will tell you where you find it. Walaikum as-salam, how are you? Are you all right?
Yeah.
MashaAllah, nice to see you. Welcome. Okay? Up to Uhud. I'm going to teach the end of the seerah. So, register your name to come and listen. Like this. We're going to teach it. The first part of it took us almost 35 to 40 weeks. 2 hours at a time. It's all recorded. You can listen to it. And it will tell you the seerah in a very different way. And we'll do that part. It can be a part of your learning. Learn that one until maybe in the new year we'll start the other course. And it will be benefit for you. But there are other courses. There is a college called CEI in Houston. They teach Islam beautifully by Dr. Saghib. May Allah bless him. He did a PhD in 20 quls, the word qul, qaf lam, in the Quran, in Oxford University. Very beautiful brother. Very good man. Many teachers come there, and I'm one of them. I only do 3 lessons a year for them. And that is very, very important for people to learn. Because the Prophet says, اطلبوا العلم, seek knowledge. Imam Malik says, العلم يؤتى ولا يأتي. Knowledge you go to, it doesn't come to you. But we live in a world whereby we pick the telephone and ring the agency. Can you send me a tutor? And when the tutor comes, say, excuse me, how much am I going to pay you? And when the lesson finished, I'm not really happy with this lesson. I don't think I need you anymore. What is this nonsense? This is why we are not gaining anything as Muslim, because we are learning the wrong way. Okay? Number two, Surah Al-Ankabut, verse 20. قُلْ سِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَانْظُرُوا كَيْفَ بَدَأَ الْخَلْقِ. Allah says, tell them, O Muhammad, to travel on the land and see how Allah initiated the creation. You know, one of the saddest things and pathetic things I can say today, when I was living in Sudan, because my house was next to the train station, the road that brings the buses and the lorries and the cars from East Sudan to West Sudan, therefore, alaykum as-salam, rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. All this, a lot of young Europeans, Americans, they used to come. I used to invite them to my house, give them showers, bring them food, and they used to ask me, how much it costs? I said, for free. It's our duty to welcome the guests. And they were very good people. In my own way, I was giving da'wah to them. I'm not telling them about Islam or anything. One day I leave, they asked me, who are you? I say, I'm a Muslim. One of them I saw when I came back to this country, many years later, I couldn't forget his face. He was a biker coming on a bike from Devon or from where, from England here. And he was giving this program. I wish that time there was a recording like that, I could record it. And he was talking about his journey, and he was advising people, if you are trying to travel to the other world, what you should do, what you should do. He says, but one thing I would like to say. I traveled by my bike through many different areas of the world. One of my best journeys in the North African desert, traveling from Morocco through Algeria, Tunisia, through Libya, Egypt, and went down to Sudan. But he says, one thing I will never forget, the generosity of the people of the desert in Sudan. And they're welcome to us in their homes and feeding us, giving us a bed to sleep for nothing. He says, that really changed my heart. I felt human. I felt human. And that's humanity. Why Islam says your guests have the right over you 3 days. But today if your guests ring the bell, you tell your child, tell them I'm not at home. So you are teaching your child to lie and you are distancing yourself away from Allah. So you need to travel. So why I'm telling you this story? I have seen all nationalities. I had never seen Muslim traveling. I don't know what are you doing? When are you going to travel? Alhamdulillah, when I came to study in this country, I rang my father in 1978 in the summer holiday. When the summer holiday started, end of my first year, I said, Dad, I'm going to come to Sudan. He said, what are you coming for? Your mother is here, I am here, your brother is here. You know Sudan, you traveled, you learned. Travel! What? He said, travel! Didn't you hear the Prophet says, سافروا فإن في السفر منافع. Do travel, for indeed in your travels you will gain benefits. And thank God he was my father. Thank God. May Allah bless his soul. I traveled. You know, my first journey, I went to Mecca and Medina. I was so happy. Because if I was doing that, I have to do it with them. But now I'm free. I can do what I think is right for me. So I did my first Ramadan holiday. Ramadan used to come in the summer. So it was my summer holiday. I went and fasted the first day, 20 days i'tikaf in Mecca. And the last 10 days in Medina, I prayed my Eid prayer in Medina and I came back. Wow. What a beautiful thing. And then after that, I went to Europe. I traveled over 80 countries. And still I feel I didn't do anything. And you are young. What are you doing? If you are a young woman, once you get married, you have got children, you have got a husband, you have got cooking, you have got whatever work you have to do. If you are a man, you have got the responsibilities. But still, if you have married and you have children, make your holidays a holiday that you can benefit from. Travel and see. Go to Morocco and see the Islamic history. Go to Turkey and see the magnificence of the Osmanic rule of preparing a Muslim to be a Muslim. Not what you hear in the news today, all this nonsense. You are hearing the propaganda all over the, oh, they were able, they did this. No, they were making us one nation. They destroyed us. Okay, so we need to wake up. And you have got the right to do that. In Surah Al-Jasiyah, verse 13, Allah says, وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَفِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مِنُ. And Allah has made everything that is in the heaven and on the earth, all of it is for you. You are allowed to use it. Some people are talking and saying, well, these people are wasting money by going to the heavens. If they have the means to do, Allah said it's allowed. Travel. Fine, learn. You know, the Muslims, the Prophet told them that your mind is the best position you have. If you are able to learn, even if you have to go to China, travel and get that knowledge. اطلبوا العلم ولو في الصين. اطلبوا العلم ولو في الصين. Seek knowledge even if you have to go to China. Literally meaning even if it is difficult to get it. But remember, خيركم من تعلم وعلم. The best of you is the one who learns than teaches. وخيرهم من تعلم القرآن وعلمه. And the best of them, those who learn the Quran, the word of Allah, and teaches the Quran. In Bukhari and Muslim and others, the Prophet says, ليس الغنى عن كثرة المال. Being rich is not because you have a lot of wealth. ولكن الغنى غنى النفس. To be rich is to be content. And in Bukhari and Muslim also, he says, صلى الله عليه وسلم, كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. You are all shepherd and you are all responsible for those who are under your care. My brothers and my sisters, please, this subject is not just about reducing what our leaders are talking about. It's about the West, extravagance that the world is living in today. Don't buy more than what you need. Don't abuse the world we live in by taking more than what you want. Allah is my witness, even in Ramadan when we are fasting, so that we can feel the feeling of the poor, in Baker Street, the Islamic Cultural Center, the Regent Park Mosque, in Ramadan, people used when the food come, they queue for it, and they take one, they go back and they come back again and take another one. And I said to myself, how much can a human being eat? And you see the food thrown all over the place. If you go last year, the year before, they stopped feeding people. Because they realized people were wasting and squandering and abusing. The simple thing Allah taught us. In order for you to be among the successful, remember everything is created for you. Utilize it wisely, but never transgress and cause corruption so the earth will have no blessing for you. May Allah reward you. May Allah guard you. May Allah strengthen you. May Allah give you tawfiq to understand and appreciate changing of the climate is because of the changing of our relationship with Allah. There is more disobedience on the earth, hence there is changes that is taking place. If anybody have any question before we make dua, please ask the question. If it's about the subject, alhamdulillah. And otherwise, if you have something else, say it and we'll finish inshallah. What time is it now? 7 o'clock?
Cool. 15 minutes to 7.
Alhamdulillah. Because there is a function taking place here. After that, we are going to have a nice, I think, mawlid by the Tijanid, yeah? They're coming here, inshallah. So, anybody with a question? I think everybody is satisfied. الحمد لله رب العالمين أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وآله أجمعين يا من ترانا وتسمعنا وتعلم حالنا ولا يخفى عليكم معرفتنا وأحوالنا يا رب العالمين اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين يا رب هيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا واجعل معونتك الحسنى لنا مددا بالأولياء بالصالحين بجمعهم من جاءنا القرآن عنهم مرشدا فرج فضلك لا هي كربنا يا خيرا مد الآن وله يدا اللهم إنا نسألك سلطانا نصيرا وحظا عظيما وأجرا وفيرا وتجارة لن تبور يا رب وفقنا توفيقا مطلقا وارزقنا حلالا طيبا واسعا بلا كد يا رب استجب دعاءنا بلا رد وآتنا اللهم كلمة لا ترد خن اللهم الجنة بغير حساب إنك أنت الله العزيز الكريم الوهاب ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the Almighty the most merciful the compassionate the kind the lenient by his mercy Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم and the mercy that he's possessing from him subhanahu wa ta'ala in his word the Holy Quran that Allah will make every word that we have said to be of benefit, Ya Kareem. Oh Allah, forgive all our sins, erase all our bad deeds. Whatever we have done in this world, knowingly or unknowingly, that will not be pleasing to you. Oh Allah, wipe it away. Exchange it to good deed, Ya Kareem, and multiply it an infinite number to allow us to be raised with that to the highest, loftiest place in Jannah. Allow us to enter the entrance of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh Allah, raise us with him in the day of judgment, and allow us to be among those whom will be with him every Friday thereafter to be with you, Ya Kareem. Oh Allah, you said in the Quran, faces that will come lit with light in the day of judgment, permitted to look at the face of their Lord. Oh Allah, allow us to be among those people, Ya Allah. Oh Allah, my brothers and sisters who came from different places seeking to be connected to you, remove every obstacle and make it easy for them to connect, Ya Kareem. Oh Allah, those who are seeking knowledge, open their heart for knowledge. Those who are seeking marriage, may you provide the best of partners for them. Those who are seeking peace and tranquility in their marriage, may you allow them to live in peace and tranquility. Allah, Ya Kareem. Those who have children, raise them to be pious and righteous. And those who have no children, may you provide for them. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all those who are sick, may Allah heal them and give them shifa and afiyah. I ask Allah for all those who are seeking work, may Allah provide for them. For all those who are working, may they earn their rizq in halal by acting in the right way and doing the right thing, Ya Kareem. May Allah remove every obstacle from our path while living in this land, in a land where there are many people who are seeking you, oh Allah, allow us to be an example for them and allow us to be a lantern of guidance for those who are seeking you, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. Rabbana ahdina wa ahdi bina wa tub alayna wa tawallana wa aghfir lana wa li walidina wa li mashayikhina wa li man allamana wa li man lahu haqqun alayna wa li ssa'il wal mahroom wa li kaffatil muslimina ajma'in. Salli wa sallim ala mubaastahu rahmatan lil alameen. As-salatu wa s-salamu alayka ya Sayyidi ya Rasulallah. As-salatu wa s-salamu alayka ya Sayyidi ya Nabi Allah. As-salatu wa s-salamu alayka ya Sayyidi ya Habib Allah. As-salatu wa s-salamu alayka ya Imam al-Mursaleen. salatu wassalamu alayka ya khatam al-nabiyyin, salatu wassalamu alayka shafi'a al-mudhnibin, alfu salatin wa alfu salamin alayku ala alibaytika ajma'in, subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun, wa salamun ala al-mursaleen, walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin, al-fatiha, bismillahir rahmanir rahim, alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin, ar-rahmanir rahim, maliki yawmiddin, iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. Now my brothers and sisters, two things, as Allah said in the Quran, فذكر, do remind, for indeed your reminder will benefit those who have faith, those who believe. Only yesterday it is discovered that Allah does what He likes. Suddenly, after many years, from the 19th century, we fought the First World War, we fought the Second World War, we fought the Korean War, the Vietnam War, the Suez War, in every African country, we created havoc on this earth, we did everything, and we did not learn anything, and come the 21st century, where we hoped in the year 2000, 12 o'clock, everything will stop, and Qiyam will take place. No. Then we went and said the South American, they said 2012. No. Because we just do what we think is right. And it is not that way. Everything is taught and everything is written. And it will only happen by His permission, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, in this world we live in today, with all these difficulties and all those troubles, Allah gave us a little virus that cannot be seen by the naked eye. Not every microscope can look at it. And we were absolutely frightened. For the first time in the history, for the last 150 years, maybe 200 years, the world stopped. I had never seen it in my lifetime. You cannot travel. I spent from March to August or September 2020 in my home. And still we're sitting at home, going out a little bit. And then suddenly Allah has changed the virus. You have mind if the Chinese virus, then it became the South African virus. And the Indian virus, and now Allah brought something new. The latest. Okay. This is your topic.
Yeah. I'm going to talk about that.
Shall yeah. Me? This professor, he's a biologist, this is his subject. He asked me if he can talk about this because this is really serious from the point of view of Islam. It's a test. The Prime Minister was supposed to give a talk before I left home now because he might be locked down again. They thought they are clever. He bought 600 million. Vaccine, although there is only 60 million living in this country. But it might not be even good. I had all of them. I had three vaccines and the flu jabs as well. But it's not the vaccine that will cure me or defend me. Allah does. This is what La ilaha illallah mean. Zamzam does not do anything for me, but Allah does. But Zamzam is the means for an end. The vaccine is a mean to an end. So believe in Allah, trust in Allah, depend upon Allah, fear no one but Allah. But my advice is, listen to the instruction given. And I see some brothers wearing their mask, mashallah. My brother put his mask. If we can wear our mask, because this new virus that's coming now, this new one that is really dangerous. And the brother, inshallah, will arrange a talk maybe next week sometime. If you are able to come and listen to him. When he told me, I said, this perfect in this time, because really we need to look after ourselves. الْوِقَايَةُ خَيْرٌ مِنَ الْعِلَاجِ. Saving yourself is better than then getting ill and looking for medicine. Yes. It's not for old or for young, for anybody, because when your time comes, you will die. Okay, but the disease we should keep away from. Second thing as well, this place we are renting from the council, and they gave us a limitation to the end of December. Please pray hard. In your own time, when you are free, say, oh Allah, change the heart of the leader of Brent Council. His name is Mr. Muhammad Butt. He's a Muslim as well. Say, Allah, change his heart and allow him to register the Carlton Center in Carltonville to be an abode thereafter forever for Rumi's care. Please make this prayer in your own time. And every day here in this center, they feed breakfast for the homeless people. And not just that, anybody who comes during the day from the homeless, the destitute, the poor who need help, support, whereby there is a lot of organizations that are closed because, and through the 2 years they have been working, please help them, donate for them, because this is what we need to do. When we help the poor, Allah will help us. And in this country, we are neglecting the duty. You know, zakah should not be sent abroad. All of us, we send our zakah abroad. But my sheikh used to tell me, where you are, if there are people in need of your zakah, because the zakah is for the people where you live. So take a portion from it, use it here. Who should we pay zakah for? The most important person, al-faqir. You might say there is no fuqara in this country. There is. There are people who are living in the street. Not because they choose to live in the street, but because they have got some difficulties in their life. Number two, a miskeen. There are Muslims living around here in small little council flats. They barely have enough. Every week we have got a food bank. Believe me. I know many of them, they come here, bring their bag, they take food. It's not shameful because they need the help. It's better that we help them for the sake of Allah, for the sake of their children. And number three, okay, they make sure anybody who's coming into this center and ask for support, whatever it is, it's provided for them, because at the end of the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked us to help those who are in need of help. If you help them, Allah will help you. And may Allah help me and help you. JazakumAllah khair. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuhu.